cheers. Here's Siddle. Oh, that ball is close. He's given him! He's given him! Peter Siddle's got a hat-trick on his birthday!
Hello and welcome back to the On The Ball podcast. This is episode 81 of the show. Pleasure to have you back listening or watching the podcast, depending on what platform you're using today. If you're new to the channel, feel free to subscribe and get around it so you can stay tuned for all future episodes. And if you're returning and already done that stuff, we appreciate your continued support. Today, I'm going to be doing my second half of my NRL review. Similar to the AFL episode I did the other week, I did the teams that missed out on finals. I reviewed their season on the eve of finals, and then I'd left the finals participants till now, and I will be going team by team. I'll be giving them a rating out of 10, discussing how I think they've gone versus their expectations. I'll be awarding best players, most improved, and just generally chatting about their season and their future outlook. And at the end of the episode, I'll be providing a little bit of a State of Origin 1 preview. So to start, I'm going to go in order of the way the teams got eliminated. So to start us off, we'll tackle the Cronulla Sharks. They lost to the Canberra Raiders in the first elimination final on the first weekend of finals. They came eighth in the regular season. For Canberra, look, it's never a bad season if you make finals, is it? As a West Tigers fan myself, I would happily come eighth. But the thing is, they never really had a good win all year. They kind of just beat teams below them. It was pretty well, like, talked about, publicised that they'd, I don't think they had a top eight win at all, if not until, like, the last couple rounds. And yeah, it was just a bit of a nothing year, really. Kind of similar to last year, just scraping into, I think they actually had more impact last year. But yeah, this year, it was kind of just inevitable they were going to scrape into finals. They've got enough star power in their team, but they're not the greatest side. But you kind of knew they weren't really going to threaten anyone in the finals series. They were all too good compared to the Sharks. But yeah, they were better than the other eight teams, so that's something to take out of the season. But yeah, they were definitely a long way off. Probably them and the Knights were seriously distanced from the top six. But yeah, they never really, there were only a couple games where they really strung everything together, and that was against some of the weaker teams. To be fair, their main ball player, Sean Johnson, did get injured in about round 14 or 15, and that saw their attacking like ability go down a lot. In terms of a rating out of 10, I operate with 5 as average. I don't go 7. I'm not like, you know, my kitchen rules or whatever, where they just hand out 7s for fun. If 5's average, I'm probably just going to have to give it a 5. This is probably exactly where we expected them to come. I don't think they progress too much, if at all. I don't know if there's too much of a future at the Sharks with this current side and current coach. I just didn't really see much progression from last year to this year. If not, there was a little bit of regression. In terms of the best players, I could have easily given it to Sean Johnson, but for me, the best player was Blake Brayley. I think he was a real unsung hero in this Cronulla Sharks team. I feel like there was more hype around Jaden when he started the Sharks, but to me, Blake's by far the better player. Yeah, he was really important to the Sharks team. He was really good, especially in the first like 10 rounds when their attack wasn't flowing as much, and then it kind of caught fire in the middle of the season. So yeah, I thought he was really impressive. Still very young, got a lot of progression over the next couple of years. Just natural progression. He's only been in the league now for like 2 years. Only been a starting hooker for like a year and a half. So going to be interesting to see how good he can become. Obviously, there's a lot of good young hookers now at the moment. But yeah, he looks really impressive. Someone else worth mentioning: Braden Hamlin Ueli. They have quite a few big names in that forward pack. Obviously, Woods, Fifita. But I think he was kind of the guy week in, week out who was doing the hard yards. I kind of forgot about Toby Rudolph, I'll be honest. Him and Rudolph, they probably were the two main workhorses of that forward pack, even if Woods and Fifita are the probably more well-known names. And yeah, Hamlin Ueli, everyone kind of expected this year. Just to keep progressing on his form in the last two seasons. But yeah, he looks like he's going to be a really reliable middle forward. And yeah, he's pretty dangerous with the ball, likes to offload. Yeah, he's just a really talented player. So they're my two best players for the Cronulla Sharks. And then most improved, Sean Johnson. I've actually got him in most improved just because he was really bad last year. Obviously, had that big move from the Warriors. And it was pretty well documented how poor his start was in his transition to a new club. But this year, came out pretty good. He started had a few slow weeks at the start. And then from about round 3 to round 10, he looked really good. I actually think he would have won. Well, I don't know. I don't know how many votes he finished on, but I reckon he would have gone pretty close to the Dally M if he played the whole year, just because, A, I don't think there would have been many people in this team taking votes from him, and B, he was in pretty good form when he did get injured. And then my other most improved was Sia Sifa Talakai. He was probably the main, like, in terms of comparing last year to this year, Talakai is probably the main difference. He's kind of given them their forward pack that X factor that they didn't really have last year, because I think everywhere else in the field they've basically stagnated, where Talakai is definitely a big improvement. He started the season as on the bench and he just kind of wouldn't stop making line breaks and scoring tries, and then all of a sudden they gave him the starting gig and he never really looked back. I think he used to play for the Rabbitohs back in 2016-17. Couldn't really break into the side there, and now he looks like a permanent fixture in that Sharks forward pack. So yeah, I'll give them a 5 out of 10. It probably sounds harsh, but it's probably exactly where everyone predicted them. I don't think anyone would have predicted them to come below 9th. I don't think anyone would have predicted them to come above 7th. So smack bang in the middle of where people would have been predicting them. So I think it's a not a bang average, that sounds negative, but just a par season for the Sharks. Going to be interesting to see what they do next year, because I don't know, I think there's got to be some player movement, because, you know, there's blokes like Fifita who are probably on a lot of money, but they're not really providing that much for the club anymore, and maybe they should consider selling some of their big names and rebuilding, or going hard and trying to bring in a few more veterans if they believe, like, you know, Sean Johnson and Wade Graham have it in them to lead this team to a premiership tilt, because right now they're kind of in that in-between range where they're not really doing much. They're going to make finals, but they're not really going to have an impact on the season. Next up, I've got the Knights, the other team to lose on the opening weekend. They lost to the informed Rabbitohs, came 7th. Look, I think everyone kind of predicted the Knights to improve this season. Obviously, came from outside the 8 to making the 8 this year. But I think their second half of the season was seriously poor. In the first half, they looked like they could have been a top 4 team. Mitchell Pearce was playing well. Everything was going pretty well. And then it has to be said, a lot of injuries hurt Newcastle. I can picture a game where Connor Watson and Mitchell Pearce both got injured. And they had like two debutants playing in the spine for 80 minutes in their first matches. And stuff like that kind of just kept happening to the Knights. And yeah, that doesn't really help your cause when you're a young team trying to bid for a spot up the ladder. But I think they did quite well to still come 7th. As I said, with the Sharkies, they were still quite a long way from the top 6. But I think overall it's a pretty solid season. If 5's average... Oh, look, they did come from pretty low on the ladder, but I think most people would have been predicting it. I'd probably give it a 6, maybe a 7. I'll actually give it a 7. I like what the Knights did this year. I think they found some good players. Well, not found, but I think they kind of reborn. No, I can't speak there. There was a few rebirths in there, like blokes like Jacob Saifidi, who's my most improved. He kind of came back from the wilderness. He was pretty good about 2 or 3 seasons ago, and then he kind of became nothing more than just a 20-minute bench player. And this year he really broke out, almost outshone his brother Daniel, actually. And his bench cameos were really impressive. Like Clemmer, obviously absolute workhorse. Daniel Saifidi, same thing. But when they used to come off last year, there was a bit of a dip in quality. But Jacob Saifidi now coming on, he's just as good as those two. So I think that was a big improvement for the Knights. In terms of best player, it's kind of hard to go past Kalen Ponga. Some people probably said he had a down year this year compared to last year, but I think he was just as good. And right next to him, I've got David Clemmer. Probably goes a little bit unsung sometimes because he's just a pretty boring player, but those meters he makes, it's pretty hard to ignore. He just sets up his side a bit like a James Fisher-Harris. So yeah, for those two, they were the best players. I can't lie, Mitchell Pearce probably had a bit of a disappointing season. There's obviously rumours that he's going back to the Roosters. The Knights don't want him anymore to lead them. And I can see why. The Knights have a pretty young team in most positions, and then they've just got this old halfback that's not really providing much. It's not like the Roosters when they had Cooper Cronk, bit of an old head to lead around the fellas. Pearce doesn't really provide that. And yeah, he just didn't really play good footy this year at all. I think Ponga was having to carry the creativity a lot. And yeah, I think it's probably not a bad move forward for the club to bring in, to go completely young, really. Gives them a good chance of building up a dynasty, you know, having several years at the premiership, in the premiership window, rather than just getting there with like a 35-year-old halfback in 2 years or something like that. So yeah, I think not a bad season for the Knights. They would have been happy to be back in the finals. It's been a while since they were in there, I reckon. Oh, it must be quite a while, actually. I don't remember them being in the finals for a long time. I would guess 7 or 8 years, but that's just guesswork there. But yeah, think there's still room for improvement. Wouldn't be surprised if they climb up the ladder even more next year with Adam O'Brien getting another year at the helm. But yeah, I think pretty solid year for the Knights. Nothing outstanding, but deserving of a 7 out of 10. Next up, we have the Roosters, knocked out in the second week of final, losing to the Raiders. They came fourth in the regular season. Similar to the Knights, they had probably worse than the Knights, actually. There was quite an injury crisis at the Roosters. Everyone was going down. You had Verrills and Radley go down with ACLs. Then Daniel Tupou missed like 3 months with a foot injury or something like that. Yeah, lots of injuries really hurt them. But ultimately, they still did pretty well to come fourth. And I think they showed in the second and third months of the competition that when they were at relative full strength, they were still one of the teams to beat. And I just don't think they had enough games. In finals, they basically had their full side, but leading up to finals, they didn't really have enough momentum with that full team. They had a lot of blokes coming back, and it was only their second or first game back from injury. So yeah, Roosters, look, it's a bit of a disappointing year just because the three-peat seemed like attainable, because you did think earlier on in the season they were the clear best team. So from that point of view, it was probably a bit of a deflating year for them. But at the end of the day, they're such a great team. They've won 2 premierships out of the last 3. And you can't really criticise them for that. Best players, I know it's very dull, but I'll give it to Luke Keary and James Tedesco. I talked about this in my awards episode if you want to go check that out. But sometimes I think we can overlook the best players in the competition because we compare them to their best. And yes, I don't think Teddy was at his best. I think he was better last year. Yes, Luke Keary didn't dominate all 20 rounds. He was very dominant in about 6 or 7 rounds, and then the rest he kind of just did his role. But Luke Keary doing his role and Teddy underperforming is better than 99% of the competition. So yeah, I think it's pretty hard to go past them for best player. Most improved, controversial one, because he got dropped for the semi-final, but Lindsay Collins, I think he needs to get more game time, to be honest. I know they've got Takiaho and Warrior Hargraves, but this guy's a star. And if he doesn't get more game time, if I was him, I'd be looking to move on. I know Warrior Hargraves and Takiaho. Actually, I don't know how old Takiaho is, but I think Warrior Hargraves certainly coming to the end of his career soon. Been decking blokes for a long time now. And I think Lindsay Collins will be able to step into that middle and really dominate it, because off the bench, he's really impressive. And he started a lot of the season with injuries to both Takiaho and Warrior Hargraves throughout the year. And yeah, I was really shocked when he got dropped in that final. I think he would have made a bit of a difference. And yeah, I just think Lindsay Collins, a bit of a breakout year for him. In terms of rating out of 10 for the Roosters, it's a tough one because they do have such high expectations. And oh, I think, like, this is so harsh, but if 5 is average compared to their expectations, I'll probably have to give them a 4, because I think it was below par for them. Not making it to the prelims, I think prelims would have been their target. Like, they obviously wanted to win, but I reckon if you made the prelims, you would have been like, yes, another bloody good season from the Roosters. But the fact that they fell in the second round, They only just scraped into the top four. The Raiders almost kicked them out in the last couple rounds. Yeah, obviously had a lot of bad luck with injuries and stuff like that, but in a year with no rep footy during the season, I think it would have suited star-studded sides like the Roosters, but they didn't really make most of it, and a lot of that is down to injuries. But yeah, 4 out of 10 for me, quite harsh, but that's what happens when you're one of the best teams in the competition over the last 5 years. Next up, we've got the Parramatta Eels. They lost to the Rabbitohs in the second week of finals. They came third in the regular season. Similar to the Roosters, bit of a strange season. Obviously did great to finish where they did in the ladder, but I don't think they looked good for 60% of the year. From about round 10 onwards, they did not look good at all. But they just built up enough of a points buffer in the start of the season that they could hang on to that top four spot. For me, best players, this could go to any of them, but Junior Paulo and Clint Gutherson, and then most improved RCG, Regan Campbell-Gillard. Campbell-Gillard, I just gave him most improved because I didn't want to have three best players, and he did come from having a few games in reserve grade at Penrith. But he was back to his best this year. I talked about him in the awards episode, and then Junior Paulo, probably not unsung, but I think he's definitely right up there in the top tier props in the competition. Someone of his size to have the speed, footwork, fitness that he does is actually quite incredible. And then Gutho, look, I live with the Gutho hater. My older brother's not a fan. I do think he is a little bit overrated, but it's hard to deny. He had a pretty good year this year. I think Moses had a really poor year, and I think Gutho really helped him out a lot in a lot of matches. Even when Moses wasn't there, he really stood up. And yeah, he saved the day a lot of the times, both in attack and in defence. Out of 10, people were legit predicting the Eels to win the premiership. I didn't really buy into the hype, so from my expectations, I'd probably give them a 6 out of 10. But against their expectations, it would probably be a 5 or a 4, because I reckon they were pretty far away from winning a premiership. And I think they, going into the year, they would have been expecting to challenge for it. And for me, the only issue, worry for Parramatta is I think they have a few players playing at their peak, and they're still pretty far away from a premiership. Like, I think this is Gutho's peak. I don't really want to talk about it, but Michael Jennings, he played well this year. Wonder why. And then Regan Campbell-Gillard and Junior Paulo probably going to be hard for them to replicate what they did this year for many years to come. Then you've got Ryan Madison probably playing at his peak. Sean Lane probably playing at his peak. I forgot about Nathan Brown. He's probably best player, isn't he? But he missed a lot of footy. Nathan Brown's probably playing at his peak. So I think their premiership window is definitely knocking. I don't think they have too long to get their act together. I think next year they've really got to aggressively target it. And I think they're not their free agency, this isn't NFL or basketball, but I think their pickups more mature age recruits have kind of suggested that they do target that short-term success. And so I think next year's a huge year for the Eels. I think if they don't at least take a step forward into winning a premiership, it might almost be like restart, and maybe Moses isn't the man to get them there. Excited to see what Dill Brown can do next year. He was looking pretty good at the start of this year, then got injured, struggled to come back from the injury, and then when he came back, he didn't really look like his full self. So, and to be fair, Moses is in that boat as well. He was playing pretty well before injury, and then he came back, didn't look good. So maybe when they both come back next year fully fit, they both play really well, and the Eels do shoot up the ladder and really challenge the best teams. But until I see that, yeah, I'm going to stick with a 6 out of 10. But yeah. Similar to the Sharkies, I think it's a big year for the Eels, and it's going to be quite a telling year. Because I don't know what the general consensus of Brad Arthur is, but I think that really bad year after they came to the top four like 2 seasons ago, I think that kind of went unnoticed a bit. I think he should have maybe had a little bit more pressure on him after that year. But yeah, I know they've come top four here, but if they have another year where they don't really look like winning the premiership, yeah, maybe the team's going to be reassessed, maybe the coaching's going to be reassessed, but yeah, good luck to them. Got quite a good side on paper, and yeah, I think Bankwest, when the fans come back, will be a fortress once again for them. Next up, moving into the second last week of finals, the prelims, we've got the Raiders. They lost to the Melbourne Storm, the mighty Melbourne Storm. They came fifth in the regular season. My best players were Joseph Tarpane and Josh Papali. Pretty easy one. I think they were by far the two standouts all season for the Raiders. And I'll say that even though they had the Dally M medalist Jack White. And most improved, similar forward pack, I'd say Dynamis Louis and Hudson Young. Both. Louis's not that young, but he's always kind of just been a bit of a bit part bench player. But this year he kind of stood up, started a lot of games, had a lot of impact. And then Hudson Young looks like he's going to be a really good player. He's only pretty young. So they're my player awards for the Raiders. Oh, once again, tough one with the Raiders, because similar to the Eels, they had really big expectations coming into the year. I think I tipped them to maybe make the final and lose to Manly, which has gone aged really well, hasn't it? But yeah, after losing the final last year to the Roosters in, it shouldn't be controversial, but it was controversial fashion. I think people were expecting them to bounce back. I think I actually tipped them for the minor premiership. Maybe that's what I tipped them for. But yeah, similar to the Eels, they had high expectations. Probably didn't meet it. Some people would say it's because Josh Hodgson left. But let's be real. If we actually compare the product with Josh Hodgson and without, they actually kind of looked better without him. And my older brother is a strong believer in that theory that Josh Hodgson actually makes him play worse. But that's another debate for another day. But yeah, the Raiders, out of 10, it's a tough one because coming fifth wasn't ideal, but then to make the prelims, beat the Roosters, that kind of changes up the vibe of their season, I feel like. If average for them was a 5, I'm probably going to have to give it a 5 just because I think them coming fifth puts it down, maybe below average, and then them winning two games in the finals, including the Roosters, I think that drags it up and they level out and just equal the average series, average season at 5 out of 10. So that's quite a strange way of thinking about it, but I think it makes sense, does it not? But yeah, the Raiders, they probably coming into it were expecting to do more in the regular season, but they hit form at the right time of year, just felt... Like, I honestly think if they were on the other side of the draw, I think they could have beaten the Rabbitohs or the Panthers and made it into the grand final. But I think the Storm were always going to be too strong for them. So, yeah, moving forward with the Raiders, another team, their premiership window has probably only got one. I reckon next year, actually, they've got quite a few good young players, to be fair. Like, Jack Wyden's not very old. Sharns is pretty young. Tom Starling's young. But in terms of like the players around that, Elliot Whitehead's pretty old. Not that he's good, but like Jared Croker's old, Rapana's old. Josh Papali's like in his prime now. So they're not like an aging team at all. They're losing Johnny Bateman this season, which is sad. They're not an aging team at all, but I think their players are starting to hit their prime. And I think, yeah, next year or the year after has got to be their year. A big year for the Raiders. As I keep saying that, but it truly is, because this year is probably a little bit disappointing, especially in the regular season, and they'll be looking to finish a lot higher in the table, because if the Raiders come top two and they have home finals the whole way to the grand final, it's going to be hard to stop them till they get there once again like last year. So yeah, that's my analysis on the Raiders. Next up, we've got the Bunnies, the Rabbitohs. They lost to the Panthers in the prelims. They came sixth. Best player was Cody Walker, really good, probably the best player in the competition in the last 6 weeks. Most improved, Tom Burgess. I've not been the biggest fan of the Burgess brothers as my time as an NRL fan. I think they were seriously overrated and kind of just loved because they were big English buffheads, but like they are nice guys, but I think Tom Burgess really stood up this year. I think the Rabbitohs forward pack going into the year was pretty poor, like pretty weak, and that was the problem with them in the first like 2 months. And then I think Tommy Burgess, along with a few of the others, Tavita Totola, all stood up. And then this guy, Keon Koloamatangi, his stats off the bench are absolutely absurd. He would genuinely have a ratio of a meet. So post-contact meters, to those who don't really know what they are, it's how many meters after the first point of contact you make. So some bloke comes up to you, tries to tackle you, It's how many meters you make after he's attempted to tackle you, basically. So it's basically like a really good stat because it cancels out all the easy meters. Like, for example, if you're bringing back a kickoff, it doesn't give you like 20 junk time meters. It takes into account the hard earned meters, and he would genuinely rack up like 70 post contact meters each game coming off the bench, which is unheard of. And yeah, he was really impressive. I remember that game. Oh, I think it was against the Cowboys. Yeah, I think it was the Cowboys, and they were scores were tied. And yeah, he made a huge charge down the middle of the field on, I think, the second tackle, and set them up for in field goal range. And yeah, that he's just really impressive. And I think Thomas Burgess must be starting to get pretty old, and Kalon Mutungi is probably going to be that replacement forward. But yeah, for the Rabbitohs, it has to say, like, although I keep mentioning the regular season, I think you can really wipe out their regular season. I think Wayne Bennett perfectly timed their run for finals. And I know you could say that for the Raiders, but I didn't. but yeah, I think Wayne Bennett knew what he was doing. I think he didn't really work them too hard in the start of the season. He knew what they did last year. It was pretty good, and he didn't want to ruin that. I think Latrell Mitchell getting injured hurt them, but it has to be said, similar to the Josh Hodgson, they kind of played better after, so I don't know. Maybe questions have to be asked there. But yeah, Rabbitohs, I predict them to drop quite a bit. I think I actually predicted them to miss the eight, because I think last year was their peak. Yes, they did drop down the ladder, but they came a lot closer to winning the premiership this year than they did last year. So I'm going to give them a 7 out of 10 because definitely exceeded my expectations. I thought they were just, once the season got underway, I was like, they're just going to do what the Sharks did. I thought they were just going to scrape into 8th and just get smacked. But yeah, they were not too far away from making the grand final. And although their defence wasn't great, I think their attack was probably the best next to the Storm. Like, I think their attack would have challenged the Storm the most out of any of the sides. Which I think would have been interesting to see. And yeah, Rabbitohs, fair play, good season, 7 out of 10. Excited to see what they can do next year. Excited to see if Luttrell can make further leaps. I was listening to a podcast, Bloke in a Bar, with Luttrell Mitchell, and he sounds like he's in a really good headspace, not to sound like some expert, but it sounds like he's like matured, and I reckon he might come out next year and absolutely kill it. I'm hoping so, because he's good to watch when he's on. And then moving on to the grand final sides. First of all, sadly, the losers. Sorry, Gus Gould. Nice even grand final commentary there, Gus. Lost to the Storm in the Granny. Obviously, won the minor premiership. Went, I don't know, bloody 16, 18, 17 unbeaten. It was some insane run there. Their only loss came to the Parramatta Eels, and that match came down to like the last play, because I remember I tipped Penrith that night, and I was actually disappointed they lost. They had a draw against the Knights, and then I think apart from that, their record went without a blemish. Look, hard to really fault Penrith this year. I don't think anyone was really expecting it. I don't even remember seeing people having tipped them in the eight this year. Like, best was maybe 7th or 8th, but no one had them coming this high. Realistically, from last year, they lost James Maloney. They added Coruscant and a few other bit part players like Tedovano. And they just skyrocketed up that ladder. So dominant, so good at home. If they continue to get home finals, similar to the Raiders, it's going to be hard to stop them making the grand final. I know, I don't think they're allowed. Yeah, they didn't host the prelim because I don't think their stadium's big enough. But in Sydney, like, the crowds came out for Penrith this year, which is good to see. And yeah, best player for me was Nathan Cleary. I think he was the best player in the comp. I talked about that in the awards episode, that he should have, well, he was the best player. Closely followed by Appy Coruscant. He made such a difference to the side. Most improved, you could really just pick anyone on the list. Jerome Luai, he didn't really have a role last year, so it's kind of hard to say improved, but like, he really was a standout this year. Isaiah Yeo took his game to a new level. Zane Tedovano came from being a bit of a myth at the Roosters to, in my opinion, one of the best bench players, bench impact players, along with Moses Leota. And then Stephen Crichton, in his debut season, he absolutely killed it at the centre position. And yeah, Panthers out of 10, look, it's like a 9.9 out of 10. The only thing more they could have done was had five more minutes in that grand final and scored another try. That's how close they came to the perfect season, really. But yeah, I don't like Ivan Cleary, obviously, as a Tigers fan, but it's hard to criticise what he's done. He's a bit of a masterclass from him. And yeah, they've just got such a large crop of youngsters. Like, I can't believe Matt Burton couldn't get a gig in that team. Like, he's a freak. Like, I don't know if it's confirmed, but I heard rumours that Trent Barrett was taking him to the Bulldogs. And I think if he does, I think he will surprise a lot of people. I really like what I see from Matty Burton. And yet, great season, Panthers. Honestly, like, basically a 10 out of 10, but whatever is as close to 10 as you can get without getting a 10, pretty much. All right, moving on to the final side, the Storm won the grand final, obviously. They came second in the regular season. For me, best player was Ryan Pappenhausen. Could easily give it to Smith. Even Munster was pretty good when he was on the park. But yeah, for me, Pappenhausen. Last year, he showed a lot of glimpses in a lot of matches, but he kind of was just more raw pace and, yeah, just raw speed and natural ability. But this year, he took his game to a new level and became a really well-rounded footy player, as Craig Bellamy likes to turn a lot of youngsters into. Most improved, similar to the Panthers, could have picked a lot of players. I thought Tino Fasimoloa really took his game to the next level, and I think Titans fans should be really excited what they're going to get from him. I heard of his name, obviously, it's quite a unique name, so I obviously saw him in the junior ranks, and he was highly touted, and then last year he played a couple games last year, and I didn't really see what the big fuss was, the big fuss of Malawi was, but yeah, this year he killed it, especially in that first 10 weeks. I thought he was really good. Justin Olam improved out of sight, became one of the best centres in the competition, and Jerome Hughes went from a fullback convert to one of the best halfbacks in the comp. For the Storm, in terms of out of 10, I think I'm going to have to rate them lower than the Panthers just because their expectations were higher. But everyone was predicting them to drop, as they always do with the Storm, incorrectly. I'm probably going to give them a 9 out of 10. So Panthers 9.999 reoccurring out of 10, Storm 9 out of 10. Couldn't have done much more realistically to get a 10, so I don't know why I'm not giving them a 10, but yeah, great year from the Storm. I can't lie, I hate the Storm until this season. I hate the whole salary cap thing. They seem like they still claim those premierships. I just hate everything about them, but this year, I don't know if any other fans did, but I grew really, like, I really like the Storm this season. They were so entertaining to watch. They were so fast, so exciting. They kind of threw defence out of the window in the second half of the season, which was so unusual to see for a Smith and Bellamy side. And yeah, they became really exciting to watch. Loved them when they were playing up at the Sunny Coast, had a little bit of a cheer squad behind them. And yeah, they, like, not that any other team's bad blokes, but off the field, they just seem like great blokes as well, like watching all their social media stuff, and they just seem like a great club to be a part of. And yeah, I grew a liking to the Storm this season. So yeah, for me, 9 out of 10, great season. And that is my review of the top 8 sides. And before we get into the State of Origin preview, I just want to say, not that anyone's listening from the UK or the Super League rugby league teams, but if the Toronto Wolfpack does, I don't know if you guys know about this, but basically there's a vote at the moment between the Super League clubs in the UK rugby league comp. Whether to allow the Toronto Wolfpack to come back into the tournament, because they obviously got kicked out because of COVID. They couldn't travel and stuff. But now they're having a vote whether they should actually even come back. And I'll be absolutely shattered if they don't. I thought that was a really great Cinderella story of NRL. And I'm not saying that rugby league was going to take over Canada or anything, but it would have just been cool to have a team in an exotic place like Toronto. Well, it's not really exotic, but it's exotic for rugby league, if you know what I mean. So yeah, hopefully those teams vote the Wolfpack in. Apparently half of them are looking likely to, which would be great to see. One day, really want to see the Wolfpack. That would be pretty bloody cool to see, watch rugby league in Toronto. All right, time for my State of Origin 1 preview. So game 1 is happening at the Adelaide Oval. I think this is the first time Origin's ever happened in Adelaide. Can't lie, little bit worried about the popularity of the game. I just think, first time it's after the season, bit of a risk, and then to also do it in a non-rugby league playing City. I'm going to find it interesting to see what the crowds are like, but I think at the moment, because of like all the COVID situation, I think most people will just find any excuse to get around a live event. So hopefully that's the case, and hopefully they can sell it out, but I don't even know if they are allowed to sell it out, to be honest. But yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what the crowd is like. I know, I can't lie, I have mixed feelings about the postseason thing. I know this year they didn't really have an option, and I'm okay with that, but in terms of moving forward, this is probably the least hyped I've ever been for a State of Origin, just because, like, don't get me wrong, at 8:05 when the lads are rolling out, I'm going to want to punch every Maroon I see, but, like, I just don't have the vibe. Like, normally, weeks before Origin, I'm absolutely keen, but I feel like 24 weeks of straight NRL action, I'm almost, like, rugby leagued out. But, yeah, I don't know. It's like each side, if you have it in the middle of the season, then after Origin, you kind of lose interest in the NRL. If you have it after the season, you kind of lose interest in Origin. So, yeah, look, trust me, at 8:09, I'm going to be right into it, my Blues kit on. But, yeah, at the moment, I'm just not feeling it too much. But in terms of the actual footy, if you compare the sides, if you compare the two teams side by side, look, I'm a New South Wales fan. I lived in Brisbane for the 8 years or whatever it was that they lost. Never saw a New South Wales victory in Queensland. How cursed is that? But yeah, this, and I have such low expectations in all my sports. I follow the bloody Tigers. I expect us to come last every year, but these teams, like, the New South Wales have to win. And yes, now I said that Queensland's going to win, but, like, I know Queensland have that intangible factor that, like, everyone knows who follows rugby league, but they just have that thing. They're always a worse team on paper, and they just somehow win. Like, they always have less depth. They just have a couple star players, but they just have that Queensland spirit. But, like, I'm sorry, these teams side by side, we genuinely are better than them in almost every single position on the field. It's just a matter of whether we can, you know, we blend well as a side, but I'd like to think we do. And yeah, I don't know. I don't want to be cocky about it, but the Blues have to win this, basically. I think this is the perfect opportunity to clean sweep them. And yeah, this Blues team should not be losing to this Queensland team. It's going to be interesting to see how it unfolds. I think the big battle is in the middle. I think that's obviously Queensland's strength with Josh Papali, Christian Welch, two really good big forwards, and then Tino up the guts, Lindsay Collins, Jaiara off the bench. That's definitely their strength. Their backline is very inexperienced. Definitely will be testing them. The likes of Philip Sammy, Branko Lee, even Dane Gagai in defence can be a bit suspect sometimes. But I think Queensland are likely going to play a boring style of footy, just try and grind it out, get metres up the middle, Cherry Evans just try and take over and then give Munster the ball in the creative moments. But it's going to be interesting to see how it unfolds. The Blues have so many stars. Might be interesting to see how they blend. Obviously, you got two stars of the competition in the centres of all positions, Gutherson and White, and so it'll be interesting to see how that dynamic works. And yeah, look, the Blues should win, but I think they'll definitely be a little bit of arrogance there from the Blues, and they might sleep on Queensland, but ultimately they should overrun them just with pure talent. But it's definitely going to be an interesting series to observe. And yeah, I don't know if I'm keen or not, I'll be honest. Like, but well, the only thing that matters is I'll be keen when the night rolls in. They're $1.35 on Sportsbet, which is probably the shortest odds you've ever seen in Origin history. But yeah, look, I love the Blues. I don't expect much from them. I've seen them lose more than they've won in my life by an absolute long shot, but they've got to be winning this match. Got to be winning this series, to be honest. But yeah, go the Blues. Sorry to those Queensland fans out there. I hope your team does well for your sake, but go the Blues. I suffered a lot in Brisbane, okay? I saw 8 Queensland victories in a row, so give me this one at least. But yeah, go the Blues. I think they should win this one. Hopefully Adelaide gets into it. Hopefully the, you know, Australian community gets into it. And yeah, thanks for joining me today. That's all I've got for you. If you've enjoyed my NRL season review, feel free to go check out my other NRL episodes. I did a Dally M Awards and I did a bottom eight teams review as well. Go, feel free to check that out if you enjoy any other sports. We do a lot of sports on this podcast. But more importantly, make sure you subscribe and follow the podcast because that way you can stay tuned to future episodes and you tune in when there's an episode on something you like. And yeah, that support I'd really appreciate that. So once again, thanks for tuning in. Enjoy the rest of your week. Enjoy Origin. And yeah, go the Blues. That's all I can say. Enjoy your day. Cheers.